We first wanted to know how much sport young people are involved in, how many physical, what type of physical activities. And that compares again the Young Life and Times with the Kids Life and Times survey. So of course one of the first things you could do potentially in the morning is to walk or cycle to school. And we found, although we know that the majority probably get a handy lift from the parents, and the survey showed that 42% of the 16-year-olds and 49%, so 1 in 2 of the P7 children, walk or cycle to school. Most of them in the KLT still get PE, but it's just about half. And the minority of Young Life and Times respondents get PE in school. Now that the slightly smaller figure might have to do with the fact that some of our respondents will have left school when they respond to the survey. They might be in a college for further education, for example, or they may be already doing an apprenticeship, and then of course they wouldn't get PE. But 44% said they would on a daily, on a weekly basis receive physical education. About 3/4 of the P7 children and about half of the Young Life and Times respondents said they also did sport outside of school. So they're not all sitting, playing on their gadgets. No, and that's, the 75% reflects actually very well the findings from the Kids Life and Times survey a couple of years ago when we asked about play and what type of play they're involved in. And it showed that outdoor play was actually the most likely activity that they were involved in, certainly at that age. It's a different story for 16-year-olds. Some did other physical activities, you know, there could be gardening, of course, things like that. We didn't ask that question in Kids Life and Times. And 8% of 16-year-olds, but almost 1 in 5 of the P7 children said they did nothing like that. Okay, let's suppose where Howard is alerted, because we need to work on this 20%. The greatest difference is gender. And probably nobody is surprised by that. Okay, and that summarizes the findings. Okay, so males were more likely to be active to the extent that the sports council or, you know, health organizations really recommend, which is every day at least 1 hour of physical activity. And you can see here that 20% of the females in Young Life and Times, but 32% of the males in Young Life and Times got that minimum level of physical activity that is recommended. Okay, in Kids Life and Times, the difference was not quite as large, you know, but still 27 compared to 37% male to female ratio in Kids Life and Times. There were more differences in relation to gender. And this figure shows that. So again, doing at least the recommended level of activity, you know, the females were almost 3 times less likely to do that than males in Young Life and Times. But it's also the fact that females were more likely to say they would like to do more sport, which probably is an interesting message for the sports council. Okay, competitiveness was much more important for males, as the third column of this figure shows. 3 times more males than females said that competing with others was very important. And interesting enough as well, we asked about sports role models, which are seen to be encouraging people into physical activity. And you can see here that females were much less likely to say that they had such a role model than males. Comparing that with Kids Life and Times, the P7 children. And here, what I want to draw your attention to is the second column, which is encouragement by the family to be physically active. And you can see here that males, boys, were much more likely to be encouraged by the parents to be physically active. They were, on the other hand, much less likely at P7 age to have a famous person as a role model. So that's very interesting, I thought, as well, that females were more likely to have a famous role model for sports, but they were less likely to be encouraged by family to be physically active. For Young Life and Times, another element that we asked, which wasn't asked obviously in KLT, is this helping with coaching. And again, we can see here that males were more likely to say that they had helped with coaching, or in fact that they were involved in a squad program. So we can see from those data that males were more likely to be encouraged by family into sport, they were more likely to be active in sport, and they were more likely to get more sports, but on the other hand, the females were more likely to say they want more. Word clots, these are the last two I think we're showing. And again, that's interesting from Anne Harris' point of view, what she was saying in terms of the type of activity that young people get involved in. These are the, we asked for the three main activities that they're doing, and it's actually the not organized activities like walking or running. Gladys, you may find that interesting, that running came out as a really important type of activity. In fact, the second most common activity. And it was only then that football and Gaelic football and things like that, so the organized activities came in. So it seems to be to us that the unorganized activities that young people undertake in their own time are the most likely activities that they undertake. In terms of facilities, of course, that's important for the sports council to know. For kids, football, swimming came out, running again, still very important. But it is sort of organized activities that we see more happening here. Now, I want to say one word more about this figure here, because it's slightly more complicated than the other figures that we present. Okay, what we've done here, we've calculated a mean score. So again, it was a Likert scale, where they could answer from one is very important, two is somewhat important, three is not important, or four is not important. And we calculate basically an average of all the responses. And these are presented here, the averages, and compares young life and times with kids' life and times. And we asked for what is important for them, why do they get involved in sport? Okay, so what is important for them? And the most important aspect here, and you can see from the score of 1.4, which is similar to KLT and YLT, which represents, it's either very important or somewhat important, so the highest score was to be fit and healthy. So that's the greatest motivator for children and young people to be involved in physical activity. Okay, to meet friends and have fun is equally important, but slightly less important than to be fit or healthy, to gain new skills, to look good. Okay, we didn't ask kids, P7 children, whether they do sports in order to look good, but we asked the 16-year-olds, and you can see that some do. So that's between, it's somewhat important. Oh, not very important, but for some people it is important, but it's nowhere near as important as to be fit and healthy. And then we asked how important it is to compete with others. And here we can see that the competitive element is much stronger, much weaker in the Young Life and Times respondents. You can see here 2.68. Okay, so that represents a not very important score. Okay, whereas for the children, the P7 children, the 2.08 represents a somewhat important score. But it's clear that competitive sport is not really important. Kids get involved in sport to be fit and healthy, to have fun, to meet friends. These are the most important things. Prohibiting factors. So if there's a difference between the level of sport that they get and the level of sport that they want to do, we ask what that is. And for Young Life and Times, and we've seen that in many, many surveys in the past, that it is time. Pressure to do homework, part-time jobs, things like that. That inhibits young people from, and you can say something about that if you want, if that is true or not. But that seems to be to us the reason why young people don't do as much sport as they would like to. Okay, that was much less the case for P7 children. Okay, only a quarter of them said they had no time to do sports. I hear someone saying the best time of our lives, I'm not so sure, but it seems that P7 children have time to be physically active and do sport. Disability or health was, interestingly enough, really just a minor reason for certainly the 16-year-olds, much more for the P7 children to say that that was a reason why they didn't do more sport. For children, P7 children, what was the most important reason was that they didn't know where the activities took place that they wanted to be involved in. So that showed us the reliance on being driven by parents or being told by parents or carers where they had to go. And that was the main inhibiting factor for them to not do more sports. The costs involved were important for a quarter of the children, for the Young Life and Times respondents. And in some of the activities that they are involved in, we could see, for example, horse riding, tennis, gym membership, of course, that all is expensive and could be an inhibiting factor for 16-year-olds. And we asked about inspiring people. people that inspire them to be active, physically active, to do sports. And it was interesting here to see the difference between the P7 children and the young people. For children, a famous person, sports icons, you know, famous person, are much more important than for 16-year-olds. At age 16, all the fame is obviously worn off, and people realize that it is really more important to have, you know, models in the family who, you know, set examples, who go out and run or cycle or do sports or run marathons for that matter. Gladys, you mentioned that. 20% of the KLT children said nobody has inspired them or encouraged them to be physically active. And again, that's an important message for the sports council, and that compares with 14% in Young Living Times. Okay, when we look at the famous people that they mentioned that encouraged them to be physically active, it was a surprise to us to see Jessica Innishill being mentioned as the most important person for, amongst all the Young Living Times respondents. But the reason is perhaps that it is the boys are, of course, divided into their favorite football teams, you know, and Cristiano Ronaldo is probably, because he's not playing in England anymore, might be there as one of the, you know, icons. Whereas when you get to the local or regional football players who are icons and famous, you know, encouraging factors for many boys who play football, then it is much more divided into Gerrard and, you know, the teams, the Chelsea's and the Arsenal's and the Liverpool's. That's why it didn't appear so often. But there are also other people like Mo Farah, Gaelic footballers, hurling players, people like that who were mentioned as factors. Now, for sports, as for KLT, it is much more the famous footballers. You know, the Cristiano Ronaldo, Lionel Messi came out by a long shot as the most important people. There are others, tennis players, old football players. I have to mention George Best here. McElroy and so forth, but it was more the really present famous people that you can see in the media. Come to the end now here, in terms of health benefits, and what was really important for us to understand whether young people and children see the benefits of health and physical activity for both their mental health and their physical health as well. And we can see that very clearly here that they do. They have an understanding that sport and physical activity is good for them, both for the physical health and the mental health, as you can see here. So Kids, Life and Times respondents were, you know, over three quarters of them thought that sport was good for their physical health, and that was 86% in Young Life and Times. In terms of mental health, maybe the children, we can't expect them to draw that connection, you know, as strongly as the Young Life and Times respondents do. So there was a little difference here that we could see. In terms of the perceived health differences or health benefits, we were also curious to see whether there's actually an effect, whether those who are physically active also assess their own health as better. And we can see here that there's a very direct connection. So those who are doing sports more than the level that is recommended, more than the 7 times a week, 60 minutes, were the ones who are most likely to say that they have an excellent health. So they're a very direct connection, whereas it was only 7% of those who never did any sport, who never in any day of the week managed to do 60 minutes of sport, who said they were excellent sport. And you can see the opposite effect at those who are saying they were poor health. Okay, so 15% of those who said they never did 60 minutes of sport on a day reported that they had poor health. For KLT, the connection is very similar and not quite as obvious, but still those who are doing 7 times or more sport in a day, 7 times or more the recommended level of physical activity per week were much more likely than everybody else to say that they had excellent health. You know, 40% roughly said that. Okay. Finally, we have a measure in Kids, Life and Times, but not in Young Life and Times, which is the Kids Screen, which is a measure of self-perceived emotional well-being. Katrina, is that roughly right? Yeah, roughly right. So, and we are able with that statistical scale to calculate whether there is a connection between physical activity and emotional well-being. And the kid screen here shows that that is very clearly the case. So those who have 7 times or more physical activity of at least 60 minutes a day in a week, we're much more likely to have a higher score on a kid screen, which indicates a better emotional well-being. Okay, the last 5 minutes, I want to move on to other key findings. And I apologize that I can't report everything in detail, but we report some findings here for all the other aspects, and we will have further events in relation to that. As I said before, the Community Relations Council is our main funder, really, and has been for many years. The OFM-DFM has been the main funder for many years on their module on community relations and minority ethnic groups. And one of the questions that in Young Life and Times we've had since 2003, since the survey started, in the way we conduct them now, is a question on whether respondents feel that community relations are better now than 5 years ago. And we are able to track that over time. And you can see it's a bit like a curve. And what is always interesting are the recent changes as well. We can see here that actually the Catholics, the Protestants, and the people with no religion differ very little in terms of their notions about whether community relations are better now than they were 5 years ago. In fact, exactly half of the Protestants and Catholics think they were better in 2015 than they were in 2010. And it's for a number of years, it's been the people of no religious backgrounds, who felt that the community relations have not improved as much as Catholics and Protestants. We also ask about future, whether young people feel the relations will be better in 5 years' time than they are now. And again, the curve is very similar. And you can see here the Catholics and the Protestants are almost in complete agreement that they will be, 40% roughly agree that they will be better in 5 years' time. And again, it's the young people with no religious background, the green graph here, which indicates that they're a bit more pessimistic, but there's no significant difference. So regardless of religious background of the respondents, really, they're very similar in relation to what they think about community relations. And will religion always make a difference? How young people feel about each other? There's been a remarkable a steadiness in relation to the responses over the last 5 years. There's been virtually no change since 2010, with about 8 in 10 respondents feeling that community relations will always make a difference in Northern Ireland and how people feel about each other. In the last 3 years, there's been no change at all. I mean, statistically, statistically, we couldn't talk about a change anyway over the last 5 years because the change has been so minimal, but there's been literally no change in the last 3 years. Something we haven't looked at really and recently, but it's very important considering the situation with the migrants that we have at the moment, is attitudes towards minority ethnic groups. And I've been looking at that. Again, it's a question that we've been asking every year except 2010, since 2004. And you can see here that there has been a change in relation to the attitudes, how young people feel about people from minority ethnic groups. The blue line are the people who say they feel quite favorable towards people from minority ethnic groups. The green line are the ones who feel very favorable towards minority ethnic groups. And you can see here, even if you add those two figures, it's about 39% in 2004 felt favorable, broadly speaking, about minority ethnic groups, and that has increased by 10% until 2015. So young people are more favorable now about minority ethnic groups than they were in 2004. And more importantly, the proportion of the ones who say they are very favorable towards minority ethnic groups has actually increased significantly. And for the first time in 2015, has overtaken the ones who feel favorable. So there's a significant improvement in relation to positive attitudes towards minority groups amongst young people. Begs the question what the UKIP is talking about and other people. This is very green and orange, but it's so on purpose. Okay, and what this figure is showing is it shows intimidation by murals, flags, and curbstones. And again, I compare when we asked this question for the first time, which was in 2003, and in 2015. Now, there's a lot of data here, so I'll talk you through that. The first two columns here compare the Catholics. And they compare the Catholics in 2003 with the Catholics in 2015. And you can see that the proportion of those who feel intimidated by both Republican or loyalist mural has significantly decreased in those in this time period. Over half of the Catholics in 2003 said they felt intimidated by murals and flags and curbstone paintings, and that has dropped to 35% in 2015. But funny enough, there were some Catholics who felt intimidated by Catholic murals as well, but even that figure has dropped to 5%. The situation is similar with the Protestants, but not quite as stark. Okay, so again, we see the drop from 35% in 2003 to now 19% in 2015 of Protestants who felt intimidated by Republican murals or curbstone paintings. And again, there are some Protestants who feel intimidated by, you know, loyalist murals and curbstone paintings, and that figure has basically halved since 2003. So it's a much smaller figure now as well. Interesting, there's almost no difference in those who are of no religious backgrounds. Okay, so there's a very small change. You know, there's less intimidation by Catholic murals, but basically the same level of intimidation by loyalists and murals and flags and curbstones. So it is a young people with no religious backgrounds who seem to be affected by that. Well, first of all, equally, rather than very differently, but secondly, most affected now. Young carers, I would have liked to show statistics here on KLT. I can't, because despite the fact that we worked very hard with young carers organizations to draft up questions for P7 children on young carers, when we looked at the data and we received them, we realized that the children didn't understand the concept of young carer. And perhaps there's learning for us. You know, we often take our survey design very serious, and we work with organizations to get the questions right, to make sure they understand the questions, as we did with the young carers. But perhaps with hindsight, we should have talked to the young people who weren't caring to see whether they understood the concept of young carer. Okay. So we can't present the data on KLT because they are simply not reliable. They overestimate the proportion of children that we know are informal carers for the families. It's a different story for Young Life and Times. The 16-year-olds understood the concept, and their findings relate to that. So we have 9% of 16-year-olds who have caring responsibilities at home. About half of them have been carers for at least the last 3 years, sometimes much more than that. Okay. Three quarters, and this is of course all interesting because the carers allowance has recently changed and the law has changed in relation to that. It doesn't affect those in full-time education because they are not entitled to carers allowance, but some of the conditions have changed which are favorable for carers. Three quarters said they enjoyed being a carer. Okay. And about half of the people said that they told somebody else that they were a carer, somebody outside the family who knew that they were caring. So caring is not necessarily an arduous job that they dread. You know, in fact, our data show that the majority, three quarters, enjoy being a carer. But it also shows, if you look at that data here, that about half of them don't talk about it very much. Okay, they keep it for themselves. They look after people who are predominantly elderly, usually their grandparents, but could also be parents, or people with physical or learning disabilities or mental illnesses. Okay, so those are the main categories. There was a small proportion of young people who looked after their parents with alcohol or drug problems as well, and we got quotes on that. People talked a little bit more about that, what that meant to them in the survey. So. We know that some of them have responsibility in relation to that. In terms of the time they spent on caring, it was interesting to see, and probably not unexpected, that the most likely response was that it's very difficult to say how many hours they spent because it changes week by week. Time depends on the demands that the people they are caring for have. So 37% said that they couldn't put a figure against the number of hours that they spend every week. Okay. The next likely response was that they spend about 3 to 4 hours a week. Of course, looking at sport and having no time and other commitments that 16-year-olds have, I mean, that's really important to know as well. I have two more slides here on child sexual exploitation before we move to the project on internationalization that was funded by the British Council. It was a follow-up project, really. We've worked in the past with Barnardos on a report which is now really well known in Northern Ireland, which was the first initial report which highlighted the extent on child sexual exploitation in Northern Ireland. And we were delighted that Barnardos came back to us to see if we can put more questions in the survey. This time the questions focused on males and their experiences of child sexual exploitation. And I want to present some of the key findings here. And Teresa's here, so if there are questions, you can talk about that, of course, later as well, and if there are questions in relation to that. We asked all the respondents whether they knew any male who had experienced child sexual exploitation. About three quarters said they didn't, and a further 17% said they didn't know anybody. They couldn't say. They might know somebody, but they weren't sure. Okay. But 9% said they knew somebody, and whether they were under 13 or 13 to 15 or 16 to 17, that was the age when they thought they were first sexually exploited. Okay. What really interested us, or Barnardos, was the question of reporting and how males dealt with child sexual exploitation when it happened to them, and the attitudes that they thought professionals had towards this issue. And you can, we asked, therefore, whether respondents felt that professionals take sexual exploitation more serious when it happens to males, females, or they take it equally serious. The pie chart here shows that 6 in 10 Young Life and Times respondents felt that the issue was taken equally serious for both males and females. There was only 1% who thought that it was taken more serious if a male reported child sexual exploitation. And basically the remaining respondents, 4 in 10, said that they felt it was taken more serious when it happened to a female. Okay. What was also interesting was, if it does happen to a male, as we know it does sometimes, are the males more likely to report it, or what are the inhibiting factors for them? And you can see here that we probably have the attitude of, you know, males being strong or seem to be strong, that it's embarrassing that it happens to them, and our survey shows that a little evidence of that is there. You know, the feeling that I should be able to protect myself, so the guilt, if it happens, then it's my own fault. Basically, 40% of the males said that that might be a reason why they're not reported, and only 35% of the females thought that that might be a reason why they themselves wouldn't report if sexual exploitation happened to them. So there is a little bit of a difference, but it's not very large. And secondly, not wanting to be seen as a victim, you know, this attitude of the strong male who can cope with anything that's thrown at them came out a little bit, but again, the difference is not really very significant. There's only 36% of males who said that and 33% of the females. So statistically, there's no difference between the males and the females. More interestingly, you know, the feeling of helplessness, the difficulty explaining what happened, is actually there's more evidence that the females are more likely to say that might be a reason why they don't report. And of course, we have very recently had a lot of coverage on courtroom scenarios, or scenarios at the police that females feel under pressure to report sexual exploitation if it happened to them. And again, I think the message is that that may need to change. Okay, now